are so thankful that you have chosen Grand Avenue as your place for worship this morning. We hope that you hear God's word and you feel his presence in our worship today. Before I turn it over to Wayne for announcements, I would just like to thank all the United Methodist women for giving me this award last week, the Dedicated Light Award. Last week I was so overcome that I was speechless. And so today I want to thank you properly. It means a lot to me because it comes from a group of very dedicated women in this church. And they are very supportive and they lift us all up. And just wanted to let you know how much it means to me, and I thank you for this. Now we'll have Wayne Westlake bring our announcements and concerns this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
In case you didn't know it, today is Layman's and Laywomen's Sunday. That's why you have Pastor Birdsong sitting over there taking it easy, and Penny is preaching. And I'm filling in also. Okay, today these pledge cards are due. Leave them back there where the offering is, or get it to the pastor or Connie or Renee or some way. If you forgot to bring it, you may bring it to the church office anytime through Wednesday noon. Some people are hesitant to make a commitment. I'm sure that if you fall on hard times and you're unable to make your pledge, we are not going to levy on your bank account or anything like that. We will be understanding, but we ask you to make a commitment. Of great lady in my church when I was growing up one time said, if you aim at nothing, you're going to hit it. So please don't aim at nothing. We look forward to it. Okay, I don't see this on the announcement, but somewhere or another I saw that there will be no United Methodist men meeting tomorrow night. Am I correct in that? Can anybody shed any light on that?
You're correct, Wayne.
Okay, yes. No United Methodist men. Next week we will be starting the Samaritan's Purse Project Operation Christmas Child. Be sure and stay tuned. Okay, we have some birthdays this week. Michelle Loy, October 18, Courtney Jacobia, October 20, Ron Stelter, October 22. Anybody else having a birthday? Is there any other announcements that I need to point out? My neighbor lady is here today. I want to welcome her. Hope the rest of you are welcome her too. Any other visitors? Okay, let's get the show on the road. Any concerns? Okay, we have an election coming up soon, and I hope you all are considering voting. When you listen to Bot Radio or TBN, there's a lot of preachers urging you to pray and then vote for our nation. The Bible says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and we want to make sure that we stay God's nation. We remain the shining city on the hill. And a big part of that, a office. Okay, we will have our prayer. Son of my soul, and When I started playing trombone, that was in the first lesson book I ever had. Okay, prayer of illumination, let us pray. All praise and thanks are yours, blessed Son of God, and to you we give all glory. How great you are, God, name above all names, and worthy to be praised. Our hearts sing to you today,
as we sing to you for eternity.
We thank you for the privilege of gathering together before you, standing together before you, standing before your throne, as your people, your church, set free by your word, made flesh, from the power of sin and death. Holy Spirit, now move among us through the words you have inspired and the testimonies of our lives. Move among us and help us remember who we are. Scripture lesson is found in Ephesians 1, verses 11 and 12, and chapter 4, verse 16. In him we were chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And chapter 4, from him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Now we will sing praise to the Lord.
Amen. Therefore, let me thank you. does love us and he reminds us all the time through his scripture, but also just in the world, the beauty of the world that he's given to us, the weather, the changes in our seasons. I'm not particularly fond of this time of year. I don't like it getting colder. But the beauty of the leaves as they turn and as they fall is a reminder of God's love for us.
Bow your hearts to God in silent prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you today in thankfulness for sending your Son to redeem us from hell and to redeem us from sin in this world and to redeem and to give us a glorious future if only we can follow you. Father, we ask you to guide us day by day. Show us what your will is, Father, and let us follow it. We pray that we will let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify you in heaven. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we confess that we need you. We need your love. We need your comfort. When we're down, lift us up. And when you lift us up, let us praise you for that. And now, as we hear us, as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay.
Creepy. Y'all have on. You can take this off. All right, well, I know none of you believe me when I say this, but this is nerve-wracking. I don't particularly enjoy standing here. I'd rather sit down there. Even if I sat down there by myself, that would feel better. So my hands are sweaty. And I gave myself a mini facial with my mask, so. I always check with Pastor Doug when I'm getting ready to do children's sermon, and I always want to know what scripture are we preaching on, and I try to coordinate that back to the kids. And I was really excited when he told me Penny was preaching and that what her scripture was. And I don't know the relationship that you guys have with your God, but my God has quite a sense of humor with me because you all know me, that's just how I am, right? Quirky. So he gives me the scripture, and I'm at work, and for those of you that don't know, my job right now is Medicare annual election period, right? So really, really busy time for me this time of year. And chaos, just absolute chaos, a lot of stuff going on, and I take a moment at work and Google the scripture. And I Google the scripture, and I'm so captivated by it that I have printed it all out, and you probably can't see, but I've underlined a bunch of stuff in here because, my God, I don't know if you've ever had your God, which is our God, of course, but he's thumping me on the head, almost flicking my ears, almost tapping me on the shoulder, almost saying, you got it yet? And there's just pieces in this scripture, and I went all the way back to the beginning of Ephesians 4, and I just want to pull out some highlights about this, because again, my God is a funny God, and my dad has slowly been giving me some boxes of stuff of my mom's, and I go through each one of those boxes, and I look at it, and I open everything, and I want to try to find her handwriting and all that kind of stuff, and my God is just so funny, right? I got this, and my God knows I don't enjoy reading. This is a really big book, you guys, really big. And I'm going, yeah, right. It's large print. That's how funny. That's how well God knows me. He's like, Angie, it's large print. By the way, he didn't know I had a big birthday this year, so he's even poking more fun at me for that. So I have started reading in this, and, you know, it's a chronological read, but for me it doesn't matter because, you know, it's October and I'm starting in January. So the things that I pulled out of the scripture today, and the whole scripture that she's going to be talking about today is about focus. And this is exactly what drew me into this, because God was sitting here going, focus, Angie. Your focus has been everywhere else but where it should be. And I was reading through this scripture, and as I'm reading through it and I just wrap it up, I had one of my coworkers walk into me and knocks on my door and says, hey, Angie, I was just curious. Have you picked up your Bible again? You had started reading your daily verses, because I had put some scripture daily readings on my desk at the office to force myself to be there and start with God's word before I start work. And he noticed it was missing. And I said, you know, it's funny you should say that, because I actually did just rekindle that back to going and reading the scriptures every night again. And I've been doing this for a while. And he goes, you know what? Me too. And I looked at him and I said, you got the same message I got? It's time that we actually put our focus where it should be and not on all of the other stuff that's going around. Because, you know, quite frankly, 2020, right? Dumpster fire, whatever. So this scripture really spoke to me when I started going back to the beginning of it. Little things like this. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. And just let that soak for a minute, for me, and I'm just speaking about me personally. You know, he didn't call me to be a cynical, angry, rushed, agitated, everything sets me on edge. That's not the type of person God called me to be. You know, he calls us all to do specific things. He gives us all specific gifts, and he just kept saying, Angie, focus on what I tell you is right for you. And this couldn't speak more to my heart about what we're living right now in Ephesians 4:18. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. It's so easy right now to look at everything and not focus on God. It's so easy to focus. There's nothing but negative out there. And so, I mean, I wish you could have seen me at my desk, because I kid you not, it was like I could just feel God thumping me in the head going, your focus is all wrong. This is what I'm telling you. You know, having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to the sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity that's full of greed. I mean, this, again, another smack to the back of the head. Ephesians 4:26, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. Do not give the devil a foothold. And that's when I was like, man, focus, Angie. You know, he goes on to say, anyone who's been stealing should steal no more, but must work. Do something useful with your hands. For me, this also, it says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building up others around you. Ephesians 4:32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as God forgave you. And, I mean, by the time I finished reading this at the office, I had to take pause. I actually had to stand up and go close my door and take pause for a moment, because if Penny's going to talk to us about focus and what we need to be concentrating on, this just couldn't be a more in-your-face for me as it was that day, because when I start thinking about focus, it's about, right, for only can we be us if we have him. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so very much for this church. I want to thank you for you. I want to thank you for your big, heavy finger that you lay on my head at times when I just need that wake up and come back. I appreciate everything you do for us. I appreciate this church. I appreciate watching on Facebook as we've all been able to have to stay home and allow us to stay in your presence. Lord, I ask that you be with all of us as we learn how to focus on where all of our concerns and our efforts should be, because focusing on you is going to allow us to be that better person that we're supposed to be and be like you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Because of the COVID, we are prohibited from passing the offering plates. There is an offering plate in the back there on the table, right underneath the clock. So be sure and put your offering there if you have not already done it. And now, do we have an offertory hymn? Thank you. Let us sing the doxology.
Praise God.
It's turtles all the way down. And so from now on, it's Penny all the way down.
Thank you for that invitation. Our second scripture today comes from John 15, verses 15 through 17. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And that so whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command, love each other. Like Angie said, today's Laity Sunday, so this is what you got. But Laity Sunday is the day when we celebrate all of you. The dictionary defines laity as ordinary people apart from the clergy. Now, I tried to verify this quote, but I don't know who said it. Some said Abraham Lincoln did, but I liked it, so I'm using it anyway. That God must like the ordinary people because he made so many of us. And God did love us ordinary people. He used us throughout his scriptures. There are so many, many stories in that Bible. Can you think of anyone less qualified than Gideon? Now, some of you may not know Gideon. He was a high judge in Israel, but he was also very timid. And God called upon him to lead an army to fight the Midianites, to get their freedom. And he started making up excuses. I'm the least of my family. I'm the least from the tribe, the least of the tribes of Israel. I can't do this. But God already knew all that. And he called Gideon, and then he put him through some tests, so that he would fully rely on him. And he dwindled Gideon's army from 30,000 down to 300 men. And he did this for one simple reason. He wanted Gideon to know that everything would be done through his power and his strength, and not by Gideon. He doesn't seek the strong or the powerful or those who have persuasive speech. He calls the least in the eyes of the world, so that he can be most glorified. Don't ever think that God counts potential with size and strength. He looks to the heart. Remember David. He slayed Goliath. David was called a man after God's own heart, and yet he was an adulterer and a murderer. But thankfully, God does not repay us according to our sins. If he did, none of us could stand. went from being a lowly shepherd to being Israel's greatest king. And then there was Paul. Paul, who was the greatest persecutor of the church, who went on to become her biggest missionary. He went from trying to destroy the church to living his life building it up. God tells us to live lives worthy of the calling that we have received. I see God at work in all the ordinary people here at Grand Avenue. I see it when I drive up out front and I see the mowed yards and how well they were tended. I see it when I read the church sign and I read the message that someone has put out there for us. I've seen it in the church garden when everyone shares in the bounty that it provides for us. I hear it in the worship music as it's played and sang each Sunday. And I hear it in the message given through Bible studies and Sunday school classes by our teachers. I see it in the United Methodist men and the United Methodist women. But I also see it in all the people who do the behind-the-scenes work, the people who serve on the committees, those who take care of the church records and the finances, and they often go unnamed. But what we don't see are the countless hours that these people spend of their personal time in doing this work. We don't see the time that they've spent selecting the music and practicing the music so it will be perfect for Sunday. We don't see the time that it takes spent making the slides for our PowerPoint for our worship service. And we don't see those who run the sound and the computer for us during our service. We don't see the time spent on keeping up with our church records and our church history and taking care of our finances and paying our bills so that we have lights and water and electricity. And then there's those who quietly slip into the church. They try not to get noticed. And they come in and they take care of the maintenance on our building, fixing all the things that most of us never even realized needed fixing, because they do it so, so graciously. And then when they're finished, they quietly slip back out again. Yet if you ask them, they tell you they prefer not to be recognized. They don't do it for the recognition. They do it for the love of their church. But today I want to tell all of you ordinary people how much it means to be a part of your group. I want to tell you that even though you go unnamed, you don't go unnoticed. I'm so thankful that God has given us so many men and women here at Grand Avenue to build us up, to help us as a whole be stronger in the Lord. As Wayne read earlier in Ephesians, the scripture says, "From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work." That means that you and I, and the person sitting next to you, we all have a part in making and creating what God has given us here in this church and in the body of Christ as a whole. We're like one big jigsaw puzzle, each of us playing an important part. And when we come together, we complete the picture that He has in mind for us. We need to plan and think about the part that we play in God's service and His greater plan for us. Scripture tells us to become completely humble and gently, be patient, bearing with one another in love. But how exactly do we get there, especially when it's difficult? How do we become ordinary people, the laity, doing extraordinary stuff for God? It's important that we work together, that we come together for each other. But we each need to be ready to play our part as the body of Christ for each other. If we, in our personal walk and as our walk with the church, if we focus on Christ, will be focused on His will for the body of Christ, and this will drive our church into the will and direction of God. We have to focus. One definition in the dictionary describes focus as the center of interest or activity. I'd like to break that down just a bit. F. Forget about what everybody else is doing. We live in a world where we worry about what our friends and neighbors have. New cars, the big house, fancy clothes, perfect marriage, a powerful job. We have eyes right in front of us, looking straight ahead, but yet we get distracted by all this other stuff around us. But when we put our eyes on God and His call for our lives will come into focus. Proverbs 4:25-27 says, "Let your eyes look directly ahead and your gaze be fixed straight in front of you. Watch the path of your feet, and all of your ways will be established." As God's children, we must keep our eyes and our hearts and our minds upon Him. Oh, one. There is one God. John 14:6 says, "He is the way and the truth and the life, and no man comes to the Father but by me." But how many times do we put other gods before our God? We try to fill our plates with other things that are outside of God's will for us, or we put them ahead of Him, and that's when we get into trouble. C, we need to continue. We need to continue to discipline ourselves and others. We're very blessed here at Grand Avenue to have so many godly men and women, but we can't just depend on them. It's our job to keep moving ourselves forward towards Christ. The pastor can't do it for us. Our lay leaders can't do it for us. We need to actively pray and study and fellowship together in order to move closer to Christ. You are worthy. We don't often hear that enough, so I want to say it again. You are worthy. We get caught up in the lies that the world tells us. We get stuck in our head and we don't know what to believe anymore. I'm not smart enough. I'm not talented enough. I'm too young. I'm too old. I don't have the finances enough to do that. I'm not strong enough to do that. I'm not worthy enough to do that. God has given each and every one of us a part to play in His building up the church. 1 Corinthians 1:26-31 tells us, "Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards, not many were influential, and not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world and despised things and things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before Him. It is because of Him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us the wisdom from God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord." God knows our weaknesses, and He doesn't expect us to ever do all this on our own. He sends us the Holy Spirit to guide us and lead us in His work. S, we have to start right now. It doesn't matter where your head or your heart were when you got here this morning. What matters is where we go when we leave here today. As a church, we need to remember the scripture that he read earlier about the ligaments Ephesians talked about. You know, in our physical bodies, the ligaments are very important because they connect our bones and they help hold us together. And once they are stretched, they become weak. And if they begin to unravel, they become weaker and weaker. That's why each one of us is so important as laity in this church. I started wearing glasses back when I was in seventh grade. As soon as the alarm would go off in the morning, I'd have to fumble around and find my glasses and get them on before I could see to shut it off. Without them, everything was fuzzy and unclear. And over the years, my lenses kept getting thicker and thicker and thicker and thicker as my eyes got worse. Finally, they got so bad that I had to have cataract surgery on both eyes. And I am so thankful that God has given the doctors the knowledge and the technology to do that surgery. Now, the lens they put in one eye is to help me see things up close. And the lens they put in my other eye is to help see things back at a distance. But God has created our brains so wonderfully that they can take both images and bring them together till everything becomes in focus. And now I can see 20/20 vision, what we call perfect vision. And I think sometimes we need to clearly see what God has planned for us so that we can focus. But as we focus on God and His plans, we also have to be careful not to develop tunnel vision, the ability to only see what is directly in front of us, to focus so exclusively on a single or limited goal or point of view. Tunnel vision can be just as bad as blindness in doing God's work. So we need to ask ourselves some hard questions, some tough things that we don't like to think about. We need to ask ourselves, where are we as a church going today? What is our vision for Grand Avenue? Are we preparing for the future 5 years or 10 years from now? Will Grand Avenue still be here then? There's an old Greek proverb that says, a society grows great when old men plant trees in whose shade they know they shall never sit. And I think that can be said for churches too. We have to ask ourselves, are we planting the spiritual trees for future generations to sit under long after we're gone? What are we doing to further God's kingdom outside the walls of this church? What do our ligaments look like to God? Are they strong and supporting each other? We, as a church, need to decide where our focus is and if we are reaching the people that God is leading us to. Are we focused on Christ and His will for our lives and His church, or do we have tunnel vision? The church is like a jigsaw puzzle. Each of us play an important part. And I want to urge you today to each think about your own personal walk with God. I know I've asked a lot of hard questions, and these are things that I struggle with too. And to be honest with you, I don't have the answers. But I know the one who does. And I know that we can go to Him in prayer, and we can ask Him the hard questions. And if we open ourselves up to listen for His answers, that He will lead us where we need to go. Sometimes we learn our greatest lessons from our mistakes. Our mistakes tend to bring everything into focus. And I realize that I've made a mistake today when I talk to you. I've talked about Grand Avenue as being my church, our church. And the truth is, it's not. Grand Avenue is God's church. We are merely the stewards and the caretakers of all that He has given us here. But I do know one thing, that there is nothing or no one that can stop God's church until He has completed His work in it. God still uses us ordinary people today, the laity, to do extraordinary things. It starts right here within each of us. Where is your heart? Are you willing to go where He leads us? A I'd like to leave you with a few lyrics from the song Oceans, Where Feet May Fail by Hillsong. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Now, if you will join me, we'll sing our closing hymn today. Here I am.
Thank you.
again next